Hey everyone, it's Mark Sargent, and this is part three of my Flat Earth Q&A emails, because I get so many emails, there's no way I can ever read them on Strange World episodes because of all the phone calls that come in as well. So let's just get right to it. Al writes, love your stuff. Morning, Mark. After accepting this years ago, speaking to my wife, who calls me the smartest man she knows, I'm just short of a genius, about this topic, she, like others, has brushed me off. Ironically, a minister at a church brought it up from the pulpit several weeks ago when it piqued my interest and I decided to look online. That's when I found your stuff. My wife brought up a question that I could not answer that you may have come across. There is a large creator that we are told was formed... I'm sorry, crater. Spell checker. Remember, guys, I'm just reading it as it is. I am not running it through a spell checker or anything grammar related. There's a large crater that we are told was formed by a large object that fell from the sky. Yet there is no object that was found. I've thought of volcanoes throwing up huge pieces of ice and melting to other theories, but can't conceive anything plausible. So, to answer my wife's question, meteors. Any ideas? Al. P.S. Don't give up. There are people in your corner regardless of the naysayers. When it comes to meteors, I just treat it like, you know, it's just another part of the system. Remember, this place, if it is big, you know, if it is thousands and thousands of miles across, if it is basically a giant Hollywood studio, then what special effect isn't possible? Meteors are easy. You know, everything in the sky is easy, including meteors. And meteors is just throwing a large chunk of metal ore at speed, you know, whatever you want to use, a rail gun or however you want to enter it, fire it into the air, let friction take its toll on it, and then it detonates, usually above ground. Try not to aim at any of the major cities, which is why that thing that happened in Russia a few years ago got a little dicey. And of course, you also got to remember, to date, we don't have any video of any, as far as I know, any meteor actually hitting anything. I mean, yeah, we've got some craters from ancient times, but those can be put in, you know, before the system even goes online. So show me a meteor. You'd think we'd get a city or at least a group of people. How many people have been killed by meteors? Should look that up sometime. Not very many. Not recently. Not in modern times. Anyway. Next one is from Jay Vale. Subject, I think this is undeniable proof that the heliocentric model doesn't work. Hey Mark, this is proof I got from Rich from Mr. Thrive and Survive's channel. And I did watch part of this video, but I'll read the email anyway. Sun rises in the east and sets in the west. When looking at the rising sun, it always curves right, southbound. When looking at the sun setting in the west, it always curves right, northbound. That should only happen during winter, I believe. But during summer, the sun should be veering left instead of right because the earth spins eastward. So if the northern hemisphere is pointed towards the sun and we spin eastward, we would start to move south, causing the sun to appear to move north. But we don't see this. All year round, the sun moves to the right as it rises in the east. It always has a southbound bend to it. Does that make sense, or am I missing something, Josh? No, Josh, I don't think you're really missing anything. You probably should, anyone that's listening to this, just look up Mr. Thrive and Survive, his recent videos on the Flat Earth, and he's got some good stuff there. I mean, everyone's got some great arguments. Do I think it's the magic bullet that no scientist can refute? No, probably not, because it's a little bit of a think piece, and three-dimensional thinking is tougher for a lot of people, which is why Rory Cooper, otherwise known as My Perspective on YouTube, his videos are outstanding, but there's a lot of people that watch him. It's like, man, I'm glad he's doing them. In fact, I'm one of them. Like he has a great three-dimensional mind. A lot of people do not. So check out Mr. Thrive and Survive's channel if you get a chance. I really don't have an opinion on this one. Let's see, Timothy writes, help. Mark, I am very, very new to this whole flat earth debate. Someone in my church was discussing it with someone else and I dismissed it as foolishness. But my curiosity got the best of me and now I am hooked. Some very compelling arguments out there on this matter. Things that once puzzled me regarding this world are starting to make some sense now. Well, anyway, what really got me was your video on Admiral Byrd. I want to learn more, so I thought I would see if there were any books. I went on Amazon, and there were a number of books about him. What would you recommend I buy? Also, could you, or answer this question first. I don't know about any specific books on Admiral Byrd. I mean, there's a lot of stuff out there, but the best one is as what it pertains to Flat Earth. I don't know if there's anything out there that strikes me. I would go after Admiral Byrd, any books that tie him to the Hollow Earth theory, and that will lead you down the path to Antarctica, because there really isn't anything that ties him to some mysterious thing in Antarctica, unless you want to look up, the details of Operation High Jump. That may be a good starting point for you. Look up books specific to Operation High Jump. You'll probably find stuff regarding the Nazis and, did we root out a Nazi base down there? And I'll reiterate my thing on that, where yes, I do think that the Nazis were down there because they were the only people that were in Antarctica during World War II. Nobody else was down there. Then we go down with a major carrier fleet in 1946, headed up by Admiral Byrd, which is Operation High Jump. And whatever was down there, we took care of it. That's the big point I'm trying to make. Where it was a major military operation, but by 1954, and the reason why I say we took care of it is because by 1954, we were, when Admiral Byrd went on television, went on the Longines Chronoscope show, he didn't seem concerned about it. In fact, Antarctica was this wonderful opportunity with a bunch of resources. So whatever happened in 1946, which was 8 years earlier, was ancient history to him. So, did we root out the Nazis? Did the Nazis seek asylum with an advanced civilization? Who were they wiped out? Did the ground open up and swallow them? We don't know. But it was taken care of. The Nazis weren't a factor anymore, and they didn't seem concerned about it in 1954. And then, of course, all that changed, and the Antarctic Treaty went in effect in 1959. And now, no corporation can ever do any work down there ever, and it's not up for debate until 2041. So that's where I first look. Let's see. Also, could you direct me to the best comprehensive resources regarding Flat Earth? There's a lot of YouTube internet stuff to sift through. Thanks for the videos and any help that you can send my way, Pastor Tim. Well, thank you, Pastor Tim. Comprehensive. Well, okay, since he's a pastor, and I did write him back on this, since he's a pastor, being if you're strong in the Christian faith, I wouldn't even direct you to my stuff. First, I would direct you to Rob Skiba's first, and then branch off from there. Rob Skiba, Skiba. His website is called testingtheglobe.com, and that'll really help you because he quotes just about every mention of chapter and verse in relation to the flat earth there is, and there's a lot of it. If you don't care if it's particularly Christian based, then yeah, I'd look at my stuff. Go to enclosedworld.com. That's good. That's the free site. The subscription site is marksargent.com. And after that, there's, just go to YouTube and type in Flat Earth and look at the top. Honestly, anything in the top 30 videos is very, very good. You don't read, the cream does rise to the top, and anything gets a whole lot of hits and a bunch of good ratings, that's where I would start. So thank you, Pastor Tim. Nathan writes, "Dear Mark, I watched your documentary last night with great interest. It was compelling. I believe you are correct on every level except one. We are not looking out onto a painted ceiling, so to speak, as I think you suggest when we look up into the sky. We are seeing the wider universe, as we are told. But yes, as you say, our planet is created by a creator, but not God in the conventional sense you describe, and it is flat. Our moon is also created too, as this article describes." And the article is ancientcode.com, irregularities that suggest Earth's moon was engineered. Yeah, of course it was. In fact, there's some great old stories. Before I finish the rest of this email, there's some great old stories about how the moon wasn't even there. Some ancient civilizations, all of a sudden realized it appeared in the sky. Or if you really want to go up to Earth 1.0 and maybe even 1.5, there was no moon or the sun. It was just various shades of light and dark, like we've done in simulations before. You don't need, if it is a manufactured system like a planetarium. A planetarium, if it wants to create light and dark, can do it anytime it wants. It doesn't need a focal point like a sun or a moon. The sun and the moon are great focal points and distractions and inspirations, but for just basic survival, light and dark, you know, how it affects living beings, you don't need those two things. So, yeah, interesting, interesting. Anyway, finish his email. If you are not aware of this already, I suggest you look into the archons, of course, as described by the Gnostics, who tellingly were persecuted and destroyed for their beliefs. They describe the archons, who are your creators of our flat earth, but not your god, which is not a man in the sky, but the overmind, which thought the universe into existence. The archons produced our flat planet and moon, too, I believe, but they are not God, but higher beings beyond our 3D realm. I suggest you research them. I think it is the final piece in your puzzle. Kind regards, Nathan. P.S. I see now why the Facebook rocket was blown up last week. The Facebook rocket. That's a great name. That's awesome. Sent by his Samsung mobile on O2. That's great. Let's see here. Tim Guba. Guba? Guba writes, "Hey, Mark. I've been following different flat Earth videos on YouTube, and I still have some questions about it. I guess my biggest one is, if we can circumnavigate the Earth east to west, wouldn't that mean we're on a round surface?" Thank you, Tim Guba. Yeah, Tim, that was one of the very first questions. In fact, it's one of the ancient questions, and that is, if you can sail around the world, aren't you sailing around a sphere? No, you could also, if you take a dinner plate and you move your finger in a circle around the dinner plate, or anything round for that matter, but a dinner plate is probably the most common, are you moving your finger around a sphere? No, but you are going in a circle. But you're saying, well, yeah, but I'm moving my finger is actually making a giant right-hand turn or a giant left-hand turn. I was going, yeah, let's say it was a really, 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 really big dinner plate. Then would you even be able to tell if you were taking a really slow left-hand turn or right-hand turn? And that's what we're saying here. Yes, if you're sailing around a sphere, technically around the equator at the very least, well, even not even the, if it's around the equator, which you can't do because you run into a whole bunch of land, you wouldn't be turning at all. But if it is a flat plane, it's going to be almost imperceptible to you. Kind of like the Neil deGrasse Tyson argument, whereas we will never be able to see, no human being without a space program will be able to even see the curve because you won't be able to get high enough. Same thing if you're trying to circumnavigate it. If it's big enough, you won't be able to tell if you're actually turning at all. The distances are so vast. So yeah, that's the answer to that question. You just wouldn't be able to tell. It's no different than running your finger around a giant flat object. Flat circular, mind you, but still a flat object. Remember, as far as the globe goes, you were told this, and I'll throw in these little digs every once in a while because, you know, people that know my stuff know my quotes, which is, look, fire burns, water is wet, you drop something, it falls to the ground, that appears to be gravity, but that's just a name we tied to it. These are all things you can test right now. When it comes to the shape of the Earth, that is something you are told. It is not something you know, it is something you are told. It's something you are re was read to you in a book or shown to you in a model. Nobody knows this. There's only 500 people that even claim to have gone to space ever in the history of our civilization, and almost all of them, 95% of them, are military. So if you think it can't be kept a secret, you are kidding yourself, because the bulk of the work was already done for them, because nobody owns a spaceship. We should have flying cars by now. This is the Jetsons argument. We should have flying cars by now. We should have the unified field and unified engines mastered by now, and we don't. Why don't we? Moving on. Let's see here. Zeta, I think, Zita, writes, if it is truly flat, then why is it dark in Japan right now, 12:08 a.m., versus my current time, 11 a.m. Eastern? Wouldn't a flat Earth have daylight night across a board? Plain. Bunch of question marks. Nope. And that question comes up. It's like the other version of that question is, how do we even have time zones if it is a flat Earth? And that is because you're not thinking outside the box, no play on words there, which is the sun cannot be an omnidirectional light source. It's got to be a directional light source to some degree. So it's not like a freestanding light bulb. It's like a spotlight. And there are physical models as well as computer simulations that will show you this. It's very much like the yin yang symbol. If you take the yin yang symbol and overlay it on top of the azimuthal equidistant map, that's pretty much it. There's your light and dark. Yes, does half of the world seem like it's light at one time? Yes, and the other half is dark? Yes, but that can be done with a directional light source very, very easily. Not hard at all. And follow-up question to this, or is that it is just a half sphere? No, it's still flat. It's not a half sphere, but the light source is only illuminating half of it because the light source is specific. It's simulating what you would expect in a heliocentric model. That's all it's doing. No different than a planetarium. Let's see here. The rest of this says, I came across your YouTube video posted by Dr. James. I saw Room 237, and that's the documentary Room 237, and I am still confused, but the pictures from the ISS of the Earth... Do you think that maybe it is because of the size of the planet is the reason why only half of it is always shown? Not sure I understand that question, but to clarify what the last couple statements were, Dr. James was one of the people that mirrored my videos. So the Flat Earth clues were literally just small segments. And a couple people stitched them into full-blown movies. One of them was Dr. James, and I believe that one was called They Are Hiding God with the Greatest Lie Ever. And the other big one was Under the Dome documentary, not based on the Under the Dome television show written by Stephen King and directed by Steven Spielberg. And Room 237 is the documentary about how Stanley Kubrick faked... he did the bulk of the work in faking the Apollo, the American space program, and felt so guilty about it that he wrote his confession in code into the movie The Shining, 1980 movie The Shining, which was also, funny enough, a Stephen King book. And he talked about Room 237. That was, if you watch The Shining with Jack Nicholson, Room 237 was the room where nothing was real. And you really ought to check out the documentary. I'm not going to do it justice here, but it's fascinating, Room 237. So check it out when you get a chance. Let's see here. Sincerely, Zeta Vigier. V-I-G-I-E-R. I got some great names sometimes. Let's see here. Subject, NASA document, linear flight equations, flat, non-rotating Earth. All caps. That is a heck of an email title. Good morning, Mark. My name is Jeff, and I would like to say that you are doing a fantastic job spreading truth about the flat Earth. I live in Missouri and have recently noticed the truth with opened eyes. I really find it hard to get my friends to see these proofs, mirrors, hydrodynamics, density, firearm trajectories, etc. I'm sorry, etc. Oof, I got to remember to say that. Somebody corrected me on this just recently. It's not etc. It's etc. As a military veteran, I know of the lies and deception firsthand from our government. Most people don't understand the lengths that the officials pulling the strings will go to deceiving the masses. I consider myself very open-minded. How do you get someone to see the truth, all caps, when they are so blinded by pop culture and science teasant? Wow. I'm not going to be using that one a lot. That they will back up the fake globe model, call you dumb, laugh in idiocracy, and get so defensive. I know that you shouldn't start with the, hey, how about that flat earth, all caps, but the few people I can talk to feel the need of a to-the-point argument. I like to start with the acknowledgement of some more simple concepts, like Illuminati control theory, and get his, hang on, I used the arrow keys and I went all the way back up to the top, and now I gotta get back down here. Sorry about this, guys. Ziegler, never use the arrow keys, use the mouse wheel. That's a little tip in Windows. Let's see, to the point argument, Illuminati control, then I get his attention, but then when I segue to the fact that hiding the flat earth is in the Illuminati master's control, this sort of works, but then I lose them. I do not know the answer is due to programming, social conformity, and the fear of being considered an outcast for going against popular belief. I have asked one of my coworkers, a Christian, what he thinks about the flat earth, and he says, it's nonsense. How do you know anything about the planet Nibiru? Ha ha ha. I want to start spreading the word and making the truth known. But I want to be prepared. I would like to collaborate with you, as I think I have a talent for making good arguments. Please see attached document referencing linear flight equations, I believe, a flat non-rotating area or disk. Have you seen this? Jeff Q from Missouri. Oh, and P.S. Please send me your survival guide. Okay, to answer your question, Jeff, I'm still going with my initial thoughts, which is the first rule of Flat Club is that you do not talk about Flat Club. Size up your audience before you go in there. I mean, entertainers do this all the time, you know, comedians and actors, you know, you don't, traveling circus acts. You don't go into a hostile environment and think you can sway them right away. All you're there is to do is to plant the seed. That's it. That's all you have to do. The rest of it will happen to them. The biggest mistake that flat earthers make on a regular basis is they forget how long it took for their own conversion. It's like for them to absorb it, to them to go through the five stages of acceptance, which is denial, followed by anger, followed by bargaining, followed by depression, and finally acceptance. They forget all this. If it took you 5 days to get your head around and a lot of lost sleep to get your head around flat earth, then why do you think you can convince somebody in 2 hours? And it's because you're so excited and you got it. And now you're thinking, well, I finally got it. I can now tell somebody and they'll get it. No, it's a time delay thing. It takes a while to soak in to their head. Just like anybody. Some people can do it faster than others. I've seen people do it in less than a day, absorb the whole concept. And yes, they are very open-minded. Other people have taken a lot longer. It took me months. But I had a lot less material to work with. The arguments weren't really, I didn't have a lot of assistance. I had to sort of work through a lot of it myself. So the big thing is I don't think there's ever going to be a magic bullet unless you actually have physical proof, unless you have someone in the mainstream endorse it. Even if we had a picture of the edge of the earth, you know, or something showing the barrier, something showing an enclosed system, so many people would say it was fake. Because you wouldn't be able to see it. You wouldn't be able to get your head around it. It's like, what do you mean it's not a globe? What do you mean it's this? Because it wouldn't be that much different than the domed structure pictures we have now that are out there. Some are way better than others. There's some computer models out there that are pretty good. Even if you had a really, really high-end computer model, people say, and it looked real, a lot of people wouldn't buy it. So don't go into any conversation with anybody thinking you can convince them right away. All you have to do is plant the seed, which is why I'm more often than not now telling people to go at it sideways. Come saddle up alongside people and say, hey, you know, I heard this really crazy theory on the internet about the flat earth. What do you think? And if they say, oh yeah, anyone thinks about flat earth is a complete idiot, then you probably knew you did the right thing by going at them sideways. Don't go into it, think optimistically. I appreciate optimism more than just about anybody. Don't go into it thinking that you can change them right away. I know I'm beating a dead horse here. You'll be fine. Just plant the seed, put the idea in their head, give them one website, give them something to look at. Say, hey, look at this. For a simple email would do. Send them an email, like say, look, I've seen this. What do you think? And let them sort it out. Let them go through the mind-bending process. Some people absorb it, some people will not. Brian writes, subject is God's big celestial clock discerning the times and seasons. Star and moon gazers will see a partial eclipse occur this Friday evening, the 16th, ooh, that's today, of September. Seems these eclipses to be a very common occurrence of late. Is there any significance to them? When they occur on God's appointed times, they do. Modern astronomy would label a partial eclipse / blood moon as a penumbral lunar eclipse. I don't use that word much. Flat Earth enclosed world believers have a different explanation of how eclipses occur from that of modern astronomers. These flat earth explanations on eclipses will become more meaningful once you decide to go out and observe things with your own eyes and record what you observe, as opposed to just accepting the scientific explanations as to how and why these eclipses occur. Thanks to one of my friends on this distribution list for sharing this very educational explanation, cause of the solar lunar eclipse, another theory on the flat Earth. Go ahead and look that up on YouTube. Do these eclipses have any prophetic significance? The book of Genesis records, and God said, "Let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years, and let them be lights in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also, and God set them in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. His prophets had even more to say about the sun and the moon regarding their significance as signs and seasons. Here's a little more explanation on the recent blood moons, solar eclipses, and partial lunar eclipses, and the one coming on Friday. And the YouTube video is called "Breaking News: Next Blood Moon, September 16th, 2016. Proof: Tetrad is now hexad." I don't know what that means. Thank you, Brian Rush, Rusch. Then he gives his email and his phone number, which I will not give you guys because you probably harass him. John writes, some of these email titles are huge. I can't believe they squeezed them all in there. "Flat Earth Truths, you'll want to read this email, especially since you have always been obsessed with conspiracies." All right. "Watched one of your videos. Great job spreading the truth. All will be revealed in good time. Had the feeling that you would find the following interesting. Although it's really not that much of a leap once you realize the Earth is flat, it's still something. Also, I like to randomly send emails occasionally in addition to all that I do. Good things tend to happen to good people, but they really happen to those who deserve it." Now, I've got a thing on that, which I love saying, and that is the Karma Cafe, which we're all in. There are no menus. You get what you deserve. "Look at the ocean. In the absence of sun, it appears black, just like space. What happens to the ocean, the water, in the most natural of places on this earth, based on where the sun is in relation to it? It's blue. In fact, it's different shades of blue, just like the sky. The firmament is partially water. Notice how stars glimmer or sparkle. Think about it." Yes, I actually have thought about it, and so has Crow 777 recently. "Who created God and the Holy Trinity of Christian theology? Before anything ever existed, there was simply nothingness or darkness. That was the state of the universe. Remember that nothing is still something. It is the non-visible. After an unknown amount of time, and somehow, nothing or darkness became conscious. The only self-existent being to ever come to be, and life began. When it became conscious, it did the same thing" excuse me, "nearly everyone does when they are alone in the dark. It turned on the light. Except in this case, it didn't turn it on, it made it. The first created being, life itself, or the visible. The bond between the Father and the Son, darkness and light, created the third being, or the invisible, or the Holy Spirit, love. Notice how a three flipped is simply a heart. So how can one being be God when there is three separate entities? It's simple. God is the Son. He is the Son of his Father, darkness, the self-existent being or life itself. He is the Father of creation, since as light, he is all that is visible. Scientifically, everything you see is simply light vibrating at different frequencies. That's how he is omnipresent. And thirdly, he is the creator and wielder of the invisible along with his Father, since their bond is the basis of all anyone feels, has ever felt, or will ever feel. Thus, three beings before time and one God. Couple more fun things for you, just because. Sunday, the day of the Lord, is actually just sun, S-O-N, day. Get it? God is the sun is light. The sun literally gives this earth light. Impossible is just a joke by God. I'm possible. Testament is actually meant to be a test. Love, spelt backwards, is a variant of its opposite, EVOL. Sound it out. evil, spelled backwards, is live, because in order for people to experience life it is meant to be lived, they must be given free will. And a natural consequence of free will is that poor choices will be made and evil will exist. Even though he allows evil to exist, it doesn't mean he doesn't manage it. A perfect example is the Holocaust of the Jews. While their bodies burned and suffered, it was simply as a simulation. Remember, God is omnipotent and can do it all. Their souls had already left their bodies and passed on long before they had to feel any physical pain. Oh, and one more thing for you, since you love conspiracy theories. The United States has already had its first gentleman. She just happens to be currently posing as a first lady. I got that one. Anyone wants to know more about that, look up Joan Rivers and what happened to her. The truth is always stranger than fiction, my friend, and all the stuff you've ever dreamed and never dreamed is out there. Think about this. If you were God, would you really create one planet, one species, one set of rules, one set of physics, one universe? Best wishes and be well, Jonathan Allen McClellan. Thank you, Jonathan. Some deep thinking there. Moving along. Dear Mr. Mark Sargent, this is Nasir Ahmad Virk in search of theories and knowledge about the flat earth. I do believe that we are living on a flat earth, as proven by many scientists and the holy books as well. I have watched this video posted by you. I think it was a one of the flat earth stuff. I have a couple of questions and would like to speak to you on the phone. I would be more than happy to meet you in person in future. We may get chance. I am citizen of Pakistan, traveling around for the last 10 years, but based in Bangkok, Thailand. I am studying about flat earth for the last 2 years and want to know more about few things in my mind. Please leave your phone number or any alternate social media link that we can have voice chat. Thank you very much. Regards, Nasir Ahmad Virk, Bangkok, Thailand. And he leaves his mobile number. Anyone who wants to contact me out of country, because I know I usually will pick up international calls, or try to pick up international calls. Let me know, and I'll try to either pick up the call through Skype or Skype you. In this case, I might be talking to Nasir out of Bangkok. We'll see. His time zone may screw me up, but that's right. Moving on. Oh, this one's fitting. From Rain and the Drops. Someone's going to get that. The subject line is The Ends of the Earth. Dear Mr. Sargent. You guys don't have to call me Mr. Sargent. My father was called Mr. Sargent. I'm not. I'm Mark. Seriously, just call me Mark. Or Sarge, if you want. Lots of people use that last name that I was cursed with. How are you? My name is Libby, and I'm from Germany. I believe in God, and today he caused me to do some more research. I am a truth seeker ever since, but I feel like so much is still hidden from me. I found the flat earth theory today, and after watching tons of YouTube videos about it, I can resume that it makes pretty much sense. I also watched your video, They're Hiding God with the Greatest Lie Ever. And after that, some questions came up, and since you put down your email address, I decided to write you. I hope it's okay. It was a little difficult for me to follow because my English is not so good, but when it comes to topics beyond small talk or daily life talk, and then it just trails off, but I tried my best. So my questions would be, one, you write God was much closer than we think. How do you mean that? In other words, where do you think he is? I think that God is, God is everywhere, and God looks at this place all the time. So I think God is all around us. I'm not saying that everybody is God. I know there's some existential people that really dig deep into the spiritual side of things and think that, we are all pieces of God. And technically, I suppose we are, because if God created us, then we are all part of God's creation. But the God conscious part is undefinable at this point. I think it's outside. I think we can't get closer to it until after we leave this place, though. That's just my first impressions. I don't usually get that question. Is there actually a wall, as in the Truman Show, behind the icy plains of Antarctica, or are these plains the wall? I think there is a barrier. I think there is a dome over this place. I think there is a firmament talked about in Genesis, where, yeah, the planes go on for a long, long ways. I think there is a huge distance between the Antarctic coastline and where the barrier is, which is why Admiral Byrd took the better part of 30 years with aircraft. You know, granted, these were prop aircraft. He wasn't using jets, but he was flying around there for 30 years trying to find the edge, and then he finally found it in the 1950s. So the 1928 and the 1950s, he was working on it. And so there's got to be a really big chunk. And of course, that's what you'd want. You'd want a natural barrier. You'd want it to be really cold with no plant life, no animal life, no indigenous anything, nowhere to hide, nowhere to take shelter, really. So that you turn it want it force you to turn back. And eventually, yeah, you get to the barrier. So that's what I think he was looking for. Number three, the elites you talk about, are they the Illuminati? Take your pick. You know, nobody knows who exactly runs the world. That's the best part. You know, is the Illuminati, is the Bilderberg, is it the Trilateral Commission, is it the Royals, is it the Rothschilds, is it it's take your pick. It doesn't really matter, because if you're truly the ultimate power, you know, we're talking about a small group of people here, really small group of people, then at least as far as I should be careful when I say ultimate power, I mean our civilization's power structure. Remember the first rule of power, and the first rule of power is be hidden. That's it. You know, do not the first rule of power, which is it's interesting because it's kind of a paradox. It's kind of the curse of being powerful, and that is you the long version of it is you never put yourself in a position where you can be overthrown, which means you can't be public, which means any position of power that is public is not the true power. So any president, any prince, duke, king, queen, dictator, whatever, they aren't the true power. They are just the front men. Because if you can be overthrown, you are not the true power. True power is hidden. You don't know who they are. They are the men in the suits in the room with no name. Nobody talks about them. They don't speak. They are kept anonymous. They are the one, the puppet masters. They are the ones that pull the strings. Every other group, yeah, they're tied to them in some way, and they may be on the boards of these groups, but they will never make themselves the leaders of these groups. They will be the leaders, and they will control the leaders of these groups. See what I mean? They are the, might as well be the worm tongue in Lord of the Rings, you know, speaking in the ear of the king. Only in this case, the king absolutely listens to them. The point is, if you can be overthrown, you're not the ultimate power in your group. That means you are just the public figure of power. No, the United States is a perfect example. We haven't had a powerful president, honestly, since Eisenhower. And Eisenhower only had power because he was a five-star general during World War II, and he commanded lots of forces, and he's a lot of his good friends were high-star generals. So he had real power. Everyone else after that was controlled. Everyone after Eisenhower, to the point where now they're just actors. Obama is nothing more than a B-rated actor. That's all he is. He goes around, gives speeches, has no emotional range to speak of. That's what he does. He's controlled, and he even his clearance. I'll give you a perfect example here, and I don't have too much time. I think I can crank out the rest of these emails though, which is the Eisenhower story, which I love so much, and some people have heard this one before, which was that even Eisenhower, after he became president and he wasn't a general anymore officially, Area 51, the mysterious top secret military base out in Nevada, was built without his knowledge and by people who were above him, above his clearance. Who built Area 51? It wasn't him, but when he found out about it, because he was military, he said, "Hey, I want to come out and check this place out." And they said, and this is how the story goes, and I believe it. They said, whoever they were told me, goes, "Sorry, you don't have clearance." And he was so insulted because at one point he was literally the most powerful military man in the world. He goes, "Yeah, let me tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to call up my buddies in the First Army who are still, you know, the generals that still run the First Army, and we're going to roll into Nevada and we're just going to take down the gates and we're going to see it for ourselves. Unless you let me come out there and check it out." And they said, "Okay, fine." And that was it. That was the last president of any power. I mean, even a Colin Powell would have gotten the bid years ago after Operation Desert Storm, or General Schwarzkopf. I don't think that even they would have had the power to do what Eisenhower did. But ever since then, what I'm getting at is even that president who had huge amounts of influence, it could do a lot of damage if he wanted to. Even he, there were things that were happening around him, and he was the one that literally coined the term military industrial complex during his farewell address. Anyway, that's a whole nother tangent, but yeah, if you ever want to look up an interesting documentary, download it or watch it when you can. It's called Why We Fight, and it opens with Eisenhower's farewell address, and it goes into the whole concept of the military industrial complex and how he built it, how he helped build it, because he was both military and he was a politician, and he realized the monster that he was helping create. And by the time he was done, it was like he had to mention his farewell address. It's like, I'm sorry, I made this Frankenstein thing, and you guys got to be wary of it. And every other president since then has gotten weaker and weaker and weaker, to the point where Obama is just he's just a front man, a character actor. So sorry. Let's see. Question number four. Ismail is taking a lot longer because he has a bunch of questions. They're good questions, though. Do you have a relation to Christian faith? Yes, I was raised a born again Christian. I went to vacation Bible school and summer Bible camp and youth group and all that other fun stuff. And it was, I was raised about as Christian, as you could be. So yeah. My mom was a deaconess. My dad was a deacon. A lot of my friends, we all went to the same church. I did drop away from it though when I went to college. Like a lot of people, you got a lot more exposure, especially me, because I was super naive growing up on a small island up in the Northwest. And then I came back to spirituality. I came back to it once the flat Earth thing got a hold of me, because try to be an atheist and say that the flat, that you lived in a dome structure and that nobody built it. Try to be an atheist. Can't be done. Anyway, he says, thank you. I'm looking forward and hoping to hear from you, Libby. So hopefully, Libby, you are listening to this. And again, anyone else that wants to write in and ask questions to me, I'm going to be doing more of these because I really don't want to ignore the emails. I know I'm kind of cherry picking right now, but I get so many. But if you want to email me and ask questions, or you have comments, or you just want me to read a statement that you've got, some sort of summary, try to put it through spell checker and try to read it yourself and check it over for grammar so that I don't stumble when I do sometimes. The email you can, of course, write me is M, as in Mark, Sargent 23 at comcast.net. Here we go. Hi, Mark. I'm not sure what I believe at the moment, whether the Earth is round or flat, although I am lending towards the flat Earth. However, I think being leading, right? I was wondering, how do you explain the argument that if you walk for a long time, can't remember the figure, and then when you turn right at 90 degrees, then walk the same distance and turn 90 degrees and walk the same distance, you end up in the same place? Doesn't that work also? Many thanks, Eddie from England. Doesn't that also work on a flat surface? Doesn't have to be on a sphere, right? And how far of a distance we're talking about here? Because remember, we're talking vast distances. The same thing is going to apply on a flat surface, is on a globe. So unless you can think of a reason why it wouldn't work on both. Anyway, hi. This is great. I gotta read this because it's just a solicitation email, and I save this one because I get these every once in a while. The person it sent me is called Divine Favor. Subject is, hi dear, I would like to be your friend. I have something to share with you that will benefit you. Write me for more detail, okay? Okay. It's fun. Olivia writes, Flat Earth questions from South Africa. Hi Mark, thanks so much for everything you have put out on this. I have so many questions. I totally buy what you're saying though. Could we possibly Skype briefly sometime? Thank you so much, Olivia Lagesson. Sure, Olivia Lagesson from South Africa. Be happy to Skype with you about Flat Earth stuff. Just let me know when you're not that far away as far as time zones go. I'll talk to you, sure. Let's see here. Ross writes, some flat thoughts. Hey, Mark, thanks for everything you've shared on this wonderful topic so far. I believe I could contribute a lot to critical thinking to this concept, and I present this short rant I just published on Facebook conspiracy page where I was tagged for my views on the subject. By the time I got there, it had been ridiculed quite a bit, so I made this as my introduction. Would really appreciate hearing your thoughts on this. Thanks, mate, and keep up the good work, and check out some of my rants on YouTube, too. You've been a big inspiration. Content. I think it, Flat Earth, maybe I'll end on this one. How much time do I got? I won't end, but we'll see. I think Flat Earth should be taken seriously and treated with the respect it deserves. It could be one of the single most enlightening shifts in human consciousness in hundreds of years, if not in human history. I first started questioning the globe-earth model some 20 years ago after reading The Secret of the Ages by Brinsley Lepoer Trench. He was postulating the hollow earth theory, aliens, UFOs, Atlantis, and so on, but one chapter really got me thinking. That was the one about the Tamarack Mine Mysteries, where they discovered that by digging straight down into the earth, it gets bigger further down. At 1 mile deep, 1 mile apart at the level surface, a shaft joining two such mile-deep shafts is 1 mile, 8 inches apart at the bottom. It turned my world inside out. Nice play on words there. Then I imagined the experiment we do with a spinning bucket at our side, rotating it perpendicularly with our shoulder as the pivot point. If you took a series of 360-degree pictures with a high-speed camera as it made one complete revolution, then overlaid those pictures on top of one another, bucket would make two complete circles, and the water level would make a third. The water would always appear perfectly flat and level in each individual shot, as it always appears on the Earth. And the centripetal force pushing it outward would explain the force of gravity. Anything on the outside of the bucket would go flying off into free space. However, I still question this model. If the entire Earth's surface is just a tiny fraction of a very massive sphere, and our atmosphere is enclosed within a sealed dome, that makes the most sense to me. Being on the outside of a spinning ball moving faster than the speed of sound with an unprotected open atmosphere existing within a vacuum of space as the ball hurtles through the universe at a combined speed of billions of miles a second. I don't think it's billions of miles a second, actually, because the speed of light is only 186,000 miles an hour. You're probably saying billions of miles an hour, though, because the speed of light, if you believe in the speed of light, and I do, is 720 million miles an hour, right? Yeah, 186,000 miles a second is 720 million miles an hour. Makes no sense to me whatsoever. But 720 million miles an hour is still very, very fast. Extremely fast. I don't believe the stars are other suns or that there are even planets. The moon is quite an anomaly, but I've got some ideas on that too. The sun itself is a portal into and out of another dimension. Ooh. That's my take on it anyway. All the best, Ross Thatcher. Thanks, Ross. That's awesome. Jerry writes, questions. Hello, just watched your video to the end. I imagine it's the two-hour video. Whenever anyone says they watched my video to the end, it's probably the two-hour thing that other people put together. Although I did, in all fairness, for a producer, I did put together all the clues into one video. It's called The Flat Earth Clues Director's Cut. I did a few different things in it. I didn't change the content. I just changed the format and the transitions, and I made it a little bit smoother and tightened it up a bit. So I think it's actually better than better quality than the others, but you know what? The others got pushing 2 million hits, so that's cool. Also, allow me to introduce myself. I am Jerry, and I have a mind that works things out without knowing why I do. What I mean is that when something is not right, my mind formulates quickly that it is fishy. My daughter recently went to Manchester, UK from Melbourne. It took some 22 hours. Yes, they stopped at Dubai. Why? My mind could not accept this time frame. Manchester is a bit less than 1,700 kilometers. The plane travels at approximately 800 miles per hour. I think he means kilometers per hour. Total should be about 13 approximate hours. This trip now she has done 3 times, and the same amount of time is spent. But I also have questions. Admiral Byrd reported he went into hollow earth. How can it be hollow if flat? I gotta answer some of his questions first. The plane flights thing, look up some plane flight videos. You'll get a lot more details on that. I'm not going to try to do it over the radio. Two, it can be hollow if it's flat because it's no different than being underneath a stage. So the hollow earth works with both a sphere and a flat model. It just means that the hollow model, it's not as deep. That's it. So if we've only dug 8 miles down, then who knows what's underneath there? There could be caverns that are, even if a cavern is down there, is only 100 miles thick, versus a sphere supposedly, which is 4,000 miles just to the core, 8,000 miles all the way across, if you believe it. Then even if it's only 100 miles thick, you could hire an entire civilization. Most people forget that our civilization, 95% of the population, lives in a very, very narrow band from sea level to about 5,000 feet. That's most of that's barely a mile. So if you had 100 miles, you could do what we're talking about here, where you have planes flying and spy planes and rockets and the whole nine yards, and no one would know any different. Who's to say we're not? That's really what it's all about. Who's to say that we're not inside a hollow earth? That we're not inside some giant cavern? Yes, I think it's a sound stage, a big studio, but it also could be a big studio carved out of rock. It could be a giant cave that we're in. We could be a snow globe on God's desk. You don't know. Either way, it's flat and it's enclosed. So, still working out the details. Let's see. How do meteors get through the field? See the earlier stuff. It's not that the meteors get through the field. I think the meteors are being introduced by the creators of this place. Now, if you want to define it as God or an advanced civilization, that's up to you. But that's the see that see the earlier response I did in the first part of this video. From the plane, and if the Earth is flat, why can't all world cities be seen at once, rather than only seeing the horizon? Because the plane can't get high enough. Remember, if it was a perfect vacuum, you would be able to see very, 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 very far. But it's not a vacuum down here. It is our air. Consists of, it's really just a thinner version of water. If water is H2O, two parts hydrogen, one part oxygen, then you gotta remember that the air we breathe is eight parts nitrogen and two parts oxygen. We only breathe about 20%. Our air is less than 20% oxygen. I know there's some trace gases in there. I'm not gonna get into that. So it's not exactly 80-20, but it is pretty much 8 to 2. So, which means it's a lesser version of water. And when you're looking through water, it's like looking through soup. There's only so far you're going to be able to look without getting distortion. So even if you're up in a plane, there's only so far you're going to be seeing. Even if there was no weather, even if it was a crystal clear day, the atmosphere alone, and I hate using that word because it has the word sphere in it, that is, you're still going to get distortion, which is what the old argument. It's like if you took a observatory telescope and you turned it sideways, why couldn't you see across an entire continent? And that's because the atmosphere is not going to let you. There's going to be way too much distortion. He also says on another side, the Bible in not is so much words, including the Book of Enoch. They mention portholes, portholes, port portals. Jeez. Could they be the way in or out? Yeah, possibly. The Book of Enoch is a great resource, and I'm thinking of doing a quick reading of that one of these days. Zen Garcia's got some wonderful stuff. I think he did with Rob Skiba regarding. I'm thinking of reading some of that. Do you have any idea what lays on the other side? More flat Earth, etc. Well, that's the big question, isn't it? If you're Matt, you think there's more land going on forever, and there's more puddles and more Earths. I think that too. I think there is more land and more puddles and more Earths. I just think they're enclosed. Thank you for trying to make the world a better place. Sincerely, Jerry. Can we do one more? Yeah, we got a couple more. We got some time, sure. The moon. Hey there, fellow biblical earther here. I have a query on about the moon. I hear it's a hologram or something like that. Why the craters? Head scratcher for me. Anywho, if you don't know, please point me in the right direction. Also, as a Seventh-day Adventist, Ellen G. White mentions in her visionary prophecies the existence of other worlds. Just FYI, your friend Franklin. As far as the craters on the moon, I think that's how it was decorated, basically. It's how it was designed. It's like, yeah, show me where craters have been hitting the moon. Where did all the craters come from? Why are they all perfectly perpendicular to it? That's the interesting thing about the craters, is none of them are coming in at angles. You don't see a bunch of skidded craters. They're all very, very pretty. They're all these perfect circles. They're all over the place. Like they just got pounded in. Like whoever was drawing the moon decided to make it aesthetically pleasing rather than to make it kind of messy. It is. Moon's really a great object. also self-illuminated. And the last question for this one is a very simple one. This is from Reality E. Subject is question: can you explain why the sky is blue? That's literally the entire email. Well, Reality, can you explain why the sky is blue? Science tells us, you know, a few things, but can you explain it exactly? I mean, yeah, you could say that it's the air, but what's it reflecting off of? For me, the sky is blue for an easy reason, and that is because whoever made it blue. Blue is an aesthetically pleasing color to human beings. We are psychologically, powder blue, as a matter of fact, is the most soothing, the most calming. You have any doubt, if you've ever been to a jail cell or a holding tank in any county or city jail, the good ones, the ones that are up to speed, they make the whole cell powder blue to calm people down. If it was red or green or brown or something else, it would create completely different emotions. Blue, I think, was the color was chosen, and that's who made it. When they made this place, they just made it blue. You know, as far as why, you know, how exactly the you know, you want to describe it as far as how the atmosphere reflects off of what and where exactly that color is from, I don't care. Because for me, it comes down to it was made blue for us. It was made blue by the creators of this place, and it was very deliberate, and it's very pretty most of the time. And everyone should get outside every once in a while and take a look at the sky and notice its blue color and see how it makes you feel. And then think about Flat Earth and wonder how it was built. Anyway, that's it. That's all I got for today. We will do more of these as I get more emails. So again, feel free to write in with all sorts. Oh, you know what? I do have one more. Sorry, I still got a minute. There was a text that came in, and I don't ever respond to texts. I've never sent a text in my life because I think they're a horrible communication. But I got to read this real quick. Hello, my name is Don. I just watched your first Flat Earth video on YouTube, and I'm blown away by it. I am open-minded Christian, and I have some questions, and I am hoping you can answer. When you talk about the tower that the people built, you are obviously speaking of the Tower of Babel, but why did our Creator destroy it? That has always confused me. If they, the people, knew, why not let them out of the dome or box? I know so much creativity came from separation, but why? Also, how does this fit into the rapture? If our creators knew we would mess it all up according to the Bible, then why let us continue to do it? If you can't answer these questions, I understand, but any insight would be greatly appreciated. Why did God screw up the Tower of Babel? That's a good one to end on, actually. Because it was over at that point. The Tower of Babel was literally a bridge to heaven, a bridge to the Creator or the God subcontractors. Once they got up there, what's the difference? You know, you built a bridge, you know, that's all they would be consumed with it. And you can't just knock down the tower because that would, you know, they would just rebuild it. They would just keep trying. They would be in constant defiance. That was the whole point, the arrogance of that particular civilization, not ours. So with that in mind, it was a clever idea. And that is, you know what, not only am I going to knock the tower down, well, the tower was eventually going to come down anyway, but I'm going to separate their languages. That's the interesting part of the story. Where it's like, you know what, let's just make it to where everybody's divided up the languages, and I'm going to scatter them all over the place so that then different cultures, you know, start up from there, and they'll forget about the tower, and no one will, you know, after a while, history is lost, and they didn't try again. Now, eventually that civilization had, I think, was removed or ascended, who knows. But that was the clever thing about it. So no. Once the tower was built, once they started building the tower, I mean, read the Bible on that one, where he said that you know, the Tower of Babel story was interesting because the passage in the Bible was that God's like, oh crap, they're gonna make it, which means there's anything, these guys will be able to do anything they want. You know, they're too good. The civilization was too perfect. Remember that the first Matrix was designed to be a perfect world. And that's what happens. Anyway, guys, thank you very much. Remember to email me if you got questions, msargent, that's msargent 23@comcast.net, and I will do what I can to read them either on air or read them here. So, anyway, thanks, guys.
Baby, what is this? What is this? Is that a model of the flat, geocentric Earth? Nice.